Good evening and welcome to Quinteview. I'm Dale Fry.
And I'm Angela Gemmel. In this episode of Quinteview, he wants to skate in the Olympics and he's doing everything it takes to get there. But he's only 11 years old. And weighing your options when it comes to losing weight safely.
And cheese. You eat it, melt it, and shred it. And tonight, a whole lot of other cheesy stuff you never dreamed of.
11-year-old boys who skate usually dream of making the big time in a hockey rink. Not so for Belleville's Chris Tessiman. He's a figure skater, and his goal is to skate in the Olympics. Bill Piazetsky now on a boy and his dream.
This is Christopher Tessiman. Christopher is 11 now, but he first started figure skating when he was 4. It's kind of odd how he discovered the sport. Christopher was involved in baseball when he was very young. One day, the parents of another child on Christopher's team told his parents that figure skating might help him improve his baseball skills. Christopher's parents gave the idea a try, and not only did it improve his baseball skills, but it also helped him discover something he loves to do today. Christopher's goal now? To compete in the Olympics someday. Canadian figure skater Kurt Browning is someone Christopher looks up to.
I think he's a very good skater. He has the showmanship, and when I grow up, I'd like to have as much showmanship as he does on the ice.
His daily routine is quite different from that of most 11-year-old boys. He usually goes to bed at 8:30 and gets up at 6:30. Christopher practices at the Memorial Arena 5 days a week with his coach Gail Ann Ellis-Heindemann. It is Christopher's motivation that amazes her.
He's very determined, a real competitor. And that's not something you can give a child. It's something from within that they have, a hunger that I'm going to do it. I'm not going to let this jump or this spin go. And that's why I was so pleased to have him. He's like a sponge. He absorbs everything you're saying. And now at this point that I've had him for a year and a half, he comes back with information to me, too. What was good, what needs to be worked on. He's right in tune with his body.
She says his skills have increased greatly since she first got him about 2.5 years ago. Christopher can perform many different maneuvers on the ice and says he's pleased with his current abilities. On top of his on-ice practices, Christopher trains 3 days a week at 1-to-1, a local fitness center. Allison Kemp, his personal trainer, started working with him about 2 years ago and says working with someone like Christopher makes her job much easier. She notices his on-ice character differs from his off-ice character.
When I go out to his on-ice training sessions and I see him on the ice, it's a very different focus. You can see he's passionate about it. When he comes here, he's having fun and he's laughing and he's fooling around and he's teasing me and I'm teasing him.
The first half hour of each training session is all cardiovascular work. In the second half hour, Christopher is with Allison doing exercises that can be directly applied to his figure skating. Kemp sees that his attitude isn't that he has to be number one, it's just that he has to do better than the last time. Christopher is a typical 11-year-old boy. He does and has everything a young child should. However, to be successful, he does have to make some sacrifices.
He doesn't watch as much TV as other children have watched and still watch. He doesn't have a Nintendo set at home. However, he does play games on the computers. He has enough time to play with his friends, and he has enough downtime. And I'm very conscious of the fact that we have to maintain that downtime for him, because that's very important that he gets that.
Christopher, like any athlete, has his good days and his bad days. They all handle their difficulties in different ways. Christopher and his father have their own little game plan when things don't go the way they should.
Since he's been about 7 or 8 years of age, we had a little sign from the stands where I'd go V to him on the ice, and that means VEC it, which is V-E-C-C. It's visualize, execute, critique, and correct. And those are the 4 steps that he would do if he fell on a jump or didn't do a spin or a spiral right. I would say, relax, keep cool, just beck it.
It goes without saying that everyone is unique. Different people have different skills and interests. Paul Tessiman is especially overwhelmed by his son's character.
I am amazed at Christopher, and not because he's my son. I'm just amazed at him as a young boy of 11 years of age, for the things that he can achieve, not only on the ice, but off the ice. He's very good at school. He goes to Albert College, and he's doing extremely well there. He's very musical. He took singing and piano. He's now taking the clarinet at Albert College, and he's doing very well at that. He plays hardball in the summertime. At the same time, he skates, because figure skating is pretty well 12 months of the year. And he does an extremely great job at baseball. And he figure skates on top of that. And I don't think any father could not be satisfied with what he does. And he amazes me every day.
For many parents, it's hard to know whether or not their child is happy. Sometimes kids tell their parents they are happy because they're afraid their parents will be mad if they say they don't like something. Christopher's father is convinced his son truly loves what he's doing.
I ask him every so often, do you want to continue figure skating? And the answer is always yes. And at one time, just recently, Christopher said, and I thought was kind of interesting, he said, I can't imagine life without figure skating. And I thought that was kind of profound.
They've never pushed me from day one to say, like, you're going to figure skate no matter what. They've always let me skate, and I've always had fun in it, and they've been very supportive.
Paul Tessiman believes that only time will tell how far Christopher can go with this.
I think what we have to do is just wait until Christopher grows into the talent that he has now, and just be patient, because right now he can do a number of jumps, a number of skills that the other kids can do, but he doesn't get the height, because of his age and size, that other boys that are in his group can get. So we just have to wait, I think, till he grows into those skills, and that will take another year or two.
Double axel is really hard because it's 2.5 rotations instead of 2, so I find that hard to do.
Christopher would like to make it to the big leagues someday, but he doesn't have to become a pro to keep his father happy.
I think in the long term, I'd like to come up to where the senior ranks and do well in Worlds and see where I go from there.
I think being a realist, all I expect from Christopher is that he succeed in life. And I'm being very sincere with that. To me, it's not going to make a big difference to me if he doesn't go to the Olympics, if he doesn't go to Worlds. I'm looking forward to just sitting back and watching him grow, choose his fields and sports, and watch him succeed, because it's certainly been interesting so far. He's a great child and a great son.
In grade 3, I left to go to Barry at the end of the school year for a week, and I went to Mariposa, which is where Doug Lee coaches Elvis Stoica. And my teacher in grade 3 asked me to interview Doug Lee. So one of the things that was on Doug Lee's desk at the time when I interviewed him, it was a little plaque, and it said, "It can be done." And I think that stayed with me throughout, like, all of my skating, and I've just referred back to it in my hard times, and it's really helped me.
What do a physician, a pharmacist, and a fitness trainer have in common? They're all important keys to losing weight safely and effectively. It may sound easy, but there's a lot to think about. Here's Shauna McDonald on taking off pounds the right way.
Weight loss is a major concern for many people. Doing it safely and keeping it off is often difficult. My friend Jen Summer is interested in losing a couple of pounds, but doesn't know where to start. Jen explains why she finds it so hard to lose weight.
I have really severe asthma, and so I find it really hard to lose weight because I can't do any strenuous exercises, and I have to eat a specific diet, and I have to, like, there's all sorts of stuff that I can't do, and I can't take certain medications and certain, like, diet pills because it will interfere with the medications I'm on for my asthma. I'd be totally interested to see what there is I can do to lose weight that's not bad for me and my asthma.
Break, Kevin McGraw has recently started to head back to the gym.
The main reason why I started working out again is to get at least a few pounds back in shape. I noticed myself a little stamina where I'm getting a little older. It's just gone down slightly, so trying to get back in shape, meet with all those younger people.
Kevin says working out is a good way to relieve stress.
The main benefit of having the fitness center in the school is well, free of charge is the main thing, and it's close to my education. So if I'm really having a really bad day, I can come down here and work out and just relieve some stress.
After leaving the fitness center, I headed to the Harbor Club. Kevin gave us some good insights, but I thought a professional might be beneficial as well. Aerobic coordinator Vicki Leggett says it is important to get a medical assessment before starting out any workout program.
Want to have someone checked out by their doctor first if they have any special health concerns such as breathing problems. Strengthening their lungs can help, but we would avoid having them work at intensities that were really high. Sometimes someone with a breathing problem can do a variety of things, they just can't work, you know, too hard at one specific program. Someone with asthma could use any of the cardiovascular machines at a modified intensity. We would ask them, you know, how they feel as they're working out, making sure, of course, they have their medication at hand. Aquafit, pool exercises are great. We have several people with respiratory problems that do the Aquafit. And if they were to get involved in an aerobic class, it might be something like an easy fit versus an intermediate or advanced level aerobic class. A lot of different types of weight loss programs, and my concern is those that aren't balanced, that encourage you to eat more of maybe one nutrient than the other. For instance, we've got protein, carbohydrates, and fats. You see a lot of quick fix diets out there. I feel that someone has to say, yes, I can continue eating like this for the rest of my life, the same way I'm losing the weight, because if they give up any of their favorite things, whether it be wine, chocolate, Twinkies, and say, I'm not going to eat or drink those things until I lose my weight, chances are when they do start eating and drinking them, they miss them so much, they go right back into their old patterns. So it is a lifestyle change, and my concern is if they're missing any of those nutrients because they're doing some specific diet, when the body has an imbalance, that's when we see signs of things like maybe ketosis, if they're taxing their liver and kidneys too much and getting too much protein, or we show signs of not enough energy, or we lose weight too quickly and call from our muscle stores and we lose lean body tissue. So it's got to be a balanced, healthy program that can be maintained for life. Canada's Food Guide is generally, you know, what I try to follow and recommend for my clients, which is about 60% carbohydrates, 20 to 30% proteins, 10 to 20% fats, roughly. It depends. I like to look at each individual and look at their specific diet and see how they're eating right now, determine maybe where they have too much of one nutrient, where they have too little. I like to recommend a lot of fruits and vegetables and whole grains. Very little of those simple sweet sugars, but we are all human and we all need to try to fit a tiny little bit of that in our diet once in a while, just so that we don't feel deprived and then eat too much of those things. And of course, lots and lots of water.
After I left the Harbor Club, I went to speak to pharmacist Tamara Bornaval.
There are certain medications that curb appetite that can also affect not just asthma, but can affect you if you have thyroid condition, if you have a heart condition, if you have asthma. Pregnant women shouldn't take these medications. And especially medications with ephedrine or ephedra in them. Any type of stimulant appetite suppressant, it should be avoided. We have over-the-counter products such as Dexatrim and Apigen that are available. There are also meal replacement products like Slim Fast that are meant to replace certain meals of the day, but not all your meals. We also have certain bulk-forming herbal products, fiber products, that are supposed to help curb your appetite. And there are also prescription medications that are available from your doctor that are supposed to help. Over-the-counter medications that aren't herbal have benzocaine in them, which is basically a topical anesthetic that would numb the gastrointestinal tract, and it's supposed to curb your appetite. And herbal products can contain a variety of medications, herbal medications, and they're very rarely tested as extensively as the synthetic products. There's also the potential for drug interactions and interactions with medical conditions, and the studies just haven't been done. There's lots of anecdotal evidence for herbal products to help cut your appetite and supposedly improve your digestion and all that stuff, but it's not proven, and you have to be very careful and do a lot of homework before you take an herbal product. I wouldn't say that they're more safe, I would just say that the dangers are known. And the Apidrin and Dexatrim used to have a stimulant medication in them that was quite addictive, and long-term use was dangerous, and that's why it was reformulated and benzocaine was added and the stimulant medication was taken out. So the danger of using a benzocaine long-term is not as great as using the older version. With herbal products, because they're not as well studied, the dangers are unknown, and therefore I would say it's greater because you don't really know what you're getting yourself into. And if you have any kind of a medical condition or take any other medications, it's not recommended without consulting with your pharmacist or your doctor to take those.
So before you start that journey to a thinner you, there are some things you should remember. Contact a doctor before starting any weight loss program. Eat balanced meals, don't starve yourself. Do your homework before taking any sort of weight loss pill. And remember, a weight loss program is a lifestyle change.
There's mild, marble, cream, cottage, and blue, and it's sometimes made thousands of liters at a time. From the cow to the table, it's a cheesy story. Jennifer Summer has all you need to know, and maybe more.
Cheese.
Cheese!
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 Cheese, yeah.
Cheese?
Cheese?
You've probably heard the age-old myth that chocolate milk comes from brown cows. But have you ever wondered about what color cow cheese comes from?
How is cheese made?
How is cheese made?
How is cheese made?
Of course, the whole milking process begins with the cows. Cows are prepped with the sanitation process.
We first put the milker on, and then we do a prep, like a sanitation type thing, and then the milker on, and when she's done, we take it off and dip her with iodine, and that's it.
So what's the iodine for?
To prevent any bacteria from getting back up into the teeth.
Well, the equipment we're using now is automatic takeoff. So you put the milker on, and then after a bit, when the cow's finished milking, then it'll come off on its own. So I have to bend down as much. Before, you had to judge yourself when the cow was done and take it off then.
Okay.
The cows are milked 3 times a day. The farmer stores the milk in a vat. It's collected by the dairy trucks.
The process here at Black River to make a cheese is starting with raw milk. Then you'll take your raw milk and pass it through a pasteurizer. pasteurizer, what it does, it heats the milk up to 161 degrees, hold it for 16 seconds, and then we'll run it through a clarifier, which will take any milk, dirty milk out of it, straw, stuff like that, that comes from the farms. And at any time we want to take the fat off, or cream, we'll take a little bit of fat off to keep the legal limits for our cheese. Then we'll take it, put it in the vats at 90 degrees. And that time we'll add a bacteria culture to it. And what that does is get the lactic acid growing in the milk a little faster. And of course, if it takes about an hour, we want to reach a certain acidity level that will add a microbial enzyme. It takes your milk and thickens it just like Jell-O. That takes the solids that are in the milk and thickens it up. Well, then we'll run a wire knife through it, horizontal and vertical knives, and that'll cut your solids into quarter-inch cubes, separates the moisture from the milk solids. Then at that time, we'll take and cook the milk up, or the curd up at that time, and 100 degrees to firm it up, and take more of that moisture out of the curd, and just get a good separation of the moisture and the solids. After another certain acidity level is reached on the whey, we'll drain the whey off it. We do it at a certain process so it keeps a certain amount of moisture on the curd. If you drain it off too fast, you'll take too much moisture off it. You want to reach a certain moisture level on it. When the whey is all drained off it, we'll pile it on both sides of the vat. And at that time, the curd will become one solid piece of curd. There's a series of seven turns that we do, and that's the actual cheddaring part. We have a curd mill that will take a little piece of curd that you buy in the store in the bags. They'll mill just like that. And then we'll add 3% of salt, or 5,000 liters of milk. We'll add 30 pounds of salt to it, to the curd. And then stir that in and take a pail and hoop it into the hoops. Press it overnight, and that's how you have your block of cheese.
How many different kinds of cheese are there?
More people eat their macaroni and cheese with a fork than with any other utensil.
France eats most cheese per capita. They have 216 different kinds of cheeses.
How did they used to make cheese?
How did they used to make cheese?
The only thing that's different between us now and say 60 years ago is we have agitators, but back then they didn't. They had to agitate it by hand. And the curd mill. Ours is motorized operated. The one they had before was hand operated, but it just had a rod that just keeps, you just push it back and forth, and that was the only difference between us. And then again, they didn't have a pasteurizer at their time too, so I mean the raw milk went right into the vats raw, where we have to pasteurize our milk or heat treat.
This area in general, cheese making, there used to be literally hundreds of small factories in the area. Now we're down to about a half dozen or so, but Central Ontario is really well known for good quality cheddar cheese.
What's your favorite kind of cheese?
My favorite kind of cheese would have to be cheddar.
Why do you like cheddar?
I like cheddar cheese because that's the cheese that they put on pizza. Because I like pizza.
Mozzarella.
Cheese.
My favorite kind is the older the better.
I like mozzarella cheese.
I like Gouda because it's Gouda.
Old cheddar. Just to me, that's the cream of the crop of the cheeses.
My favorite kind of cheese is that old cheese that sits on the shelf for 4 years and you buy it and it tastes real raunchy.
I like 5-year-old cheddar. Yeah, the older the better, sort of thing.
Sanitation is the most important thing in the plant. Reason being, we're dealing with a live organism, the culture, and we don't want any other bacteria to overpower that called that bacteria. Any cheese will mold if it's exposed to the air, because mold's in the air.
Oh, I see.
So we vacuum pack everything, and the only time the cheese will mold is if the package loses its vacuum.
Oh, okay, so mold is a bad thing then, even in the aging process. Okay.
For cheddar cheese, yeah.
Okay. Now, is blue cheese really, is that really mold inside the cheese?
It's real mold, but it's a specific strain of mold. Like, it's not just what's in there.
It's not like the blue fuzzy stuff?
No.
Okay.
We put a strong emphasis on that, obviously, and our customers demand it from us. And actually, the industry trend is there's some programs out there, HACCP, which we're moving towards, going more and more towards a more sanitary environment. But we keep a very strict sanitary environment here.
Cheese is used as glue, and some very mature cheeses are used as cement.
Until the late 19th century, people used to pay their rent with cheese.
The price for cheese is getting higher because demand is going up. Now that you're familiar with cow cheese, did you know there's goat cheese and sheep cheese? These different cheeses are available at specialty food shops. But would you really want to eat donkey cheese?
Cheese, cheese, cheese. I love it because it tastes so great.
Cheese.
Stay that way, and we feel there's a real market out there for the consumer who wants the specialty family-owned little guy, where our emphasis is still on quality, not necessarily quantity. And we feel there's a real and a continuing market. We feel our growth is sort of some really good possibilities out there. Anyways, we've grown quite a bit in the last few years, and we intend to continue that growth as well.
There's a variety of events coming up in the Quinte region. Give us the rundown, Dale.
Thanks, Angela. An Aileen Cherry retrospective is being held at the Belleville Public Library Gallery until November the 25th. The main gallery will feature a display of impressionistic paintings by the late artist. For more information, you can contact the Belleville Public Library at 968-6731. The third annual Make a Kids Christmas Auction will be held on Saturday, November the 27th. It will be held at Centennial Secondary School in Belleville, and all proceeds from the auction will help pay for toys bought by the Belleville Fire Department to give out to local kids. The auction will begin at 11 a.m. in the school's cafeteria. And finally, tickets are still available for the Belleville Theatre Guild's presentation of Patrick Hamilton's Angel Street. The play runs from December 2nd to December 18th at 8 p.m. at the Pinnacle Playhouse. Tickets are $13 each and are available at 967-1657. Proceeds will go to the Parkdale Community Center Building Fund.
That second story on weight loss was really interesting.
Yeah, it's important to see that, you know, you got to maintain your health during the wintertime as well.
I work out 3 to 5 times a week. What do you do to stay in shape?
Well, I don't do nothing 3 to 5 times a week, but, you know, I'm a Canadian boy, so I love playing hockey, and I've, you know, always played hockey growing up.
Is there anything else besides hockey that you're interested in?
Well, I've always heard about this paintball.
Well, you're in luck, because on next week's show, there's a story on just that. It's messy, and it's a lot of fun, getting splattered by a so-called bullet filled with paint. And when was the last time you shopped in downtown Belleville? What would it take to get you back? And we'll examine the controversy surrounding the use of hemp. Are we wasting an important resource?
If you have any ideas or suggestions for a Quinteview segment, please contact us at Loyalist College, Box 4200, Belleville, Ontario, K8N5B9, or call us at 969-1913, extension 2364.
Thanks for watching. Good night.
Good night.